Marketing, and we are going to get marketing. I'm going to show you a bunch of great ideas. We're going to talk a little bit about trends for pizza and ice cream, and then we're going to show you some case studies of different clients we've worked with. These are some of the clients we've worked with over the past 20 years. In case you wonder, I don't have kids. We do a lot of work because we've been working for these clients for a long time. Some of them we don't work with anymore, some of them we do, but really happy to answer questions at the end. We also have my book today, which is called Recipes for Restaurateurs. It'll be on sale at the end, and you can ask questions, join our mailing list, and all sorts of fun things. But I want to start off, you know, nothing new. Everybody knows that the landscape has changed. You know, even here in Ohio, every state has been challenged, from menu labeling to obesity issues, salt in the food, you know, you name it, we have issues. And then you add politics on top of that. There's been a lot of change over the past few years. And ultimately, what we're seeing are consumers have cut back. You know, I've cut back, you've cut back, you know, you're driving less or spending less, but more importantly, people have changed their thinking about where they're going to eat. And we're going to talk a little bit about that. Consumers are completely now choosing where to go eat if they're eating less, and the idea is, how do you get those fewer dollars into your stores or your restaurants? Most important thing to look at is that brand leaders make changes. You know, there's a lot of clients that we go in and talk to, and they're like, well, we've always done it this way. And we've always done it this way isn't going to work anymore, because consumers have changed, they're modifying their behaviors, and the top brands have to modify theirs. Some of you have seen McDonald's. I noticed one right in coming into the airport. No longer has the golden arches. It has more of a sleek design, something more like this without the, you know, the then and the now. You know, so even our top brands are making changes. Coca-Cola and the Freestyle machine. You know, now if you look at carbonated beverages, you can see that waters and flavored juices are even more popular than some of the carbonated beverages. So a lot's changing. Nothing is the same. And the question I have, it has changed food service forever, but have you changed? So let's look at some ways that you can change. Most important thing today is to stand out, to be the consumer's choice. And how you do that, I'm going to show you some great ideas. But first we're going to take a look at some pizza and ice cream findings. These statistics, I'm sure, change every minute of the day. But for overall, you know, ultimately, pizza is one of the most convenient things that people crave. They love pizza. This country loves to eat pizza, consumed by 62% of people. You know, fifth being most important is price. One of the things that I find a lot of pizza operators thinking is that you always have to be couponing. I'm going to show you a case study in a little bit of a local client that we work with, has 8 units, and we stopped discounting for them and started doing some other promotions, and their sales are up double digits. So even looking at some more consumer findings, I don't want to read through every single one, but the majority of consumers eat pizza once a month. You know, I eat it like once a day now, I think. Consumers have been trading down to pizza. So instead of going to Chili's, Applebee's, and some of the higher end casual dining, they're stepping back to pizza. Frozen pizza's improved. We see CPK. We see a lot of new kinds of pizzas in the frozen food section. And close to a fifth of consumers say that they buy pizza based on new items. So we're going to talk a little bit about that. I'm sure you guys have looked at some new ideas out on the show floor. And 2 out of 5 consumers say that they like pizza establishments that offer healthier ingredients, which I'm sure you also saw all over the show, gluten-free, natural, organics, and some of those trends. And then limited serves chains are differentiating themselves from local independents by featuring signature pizzas. You know that, I'm sure. Streamlined digital ordering. Papa John's has just done an amazing job. Pizza Hut and their smartphone applications. Innovative fun toppings have kind of come out of some of the brands. You've seen Pizza Fusion, Extreme Pizza, Z Pizza, and then expanded offerings into lasagna and pastas by some of the top brands, including like Domino's and their oven-baked sandwiches. And then all natural ingredients. Amy's Kitchen, a brand from California that's been doing, you know, amazing natural organic products for years, becoming even more and more popular. So of course they're moving their manufacturing plant out of California so they can do it cheaper. And like I mentioned before, higher quality frozen pizza. Now how many of you are here for ice cream? All right, we've got a few ice creamers. I don't see students. Any students in the room? One, two, okay, good. They know everything already. Ice cream is one of the supermarket's largest items in the supermarket, which I thought was amazing. This is new stats that just came out. $20 billion in annual sales. Who cares about a diet, I think that says. And if you wondered, it takes an average person just about 50 licks to polish off a single scoop of ice cream. Your trivia of the day. And the trend towards ice cream is certainly indulgence. A lot of the new flavors, are blowing people's minds. I know there's been bacon flavors. Some of the flavors I saw on the show were amazing. But still, super premium quality is still outselling regular ice cream. And low fat is still a low number. But one of the areas that I think we're going to see is some of these items where it's more of a frozen cultured soy product, maybe with soybeans. One of the things I asked every booth out there was, did anybody have sugar-free? And no one had sugar-free. As our baby boomers are getting older and our doctors are saying your blood pressure's terrible, you need to start cutting back on sugar. And if you look at the opportunity for ice cream in sugar-free, it's wide open because there isn't any. Snack day part is growing. I bumped into a gentleman earlier today that said they're looking at adding ice cream to their pizza menu, and I have a great example of that, of a chain that we recently did that for. The snack day part, people are starting to do meal replacement. You know, it's the Jamba juices and the smoothies or the Greek frozen yogurt, like you might have seen out there today, that are starting to become meal replacement. If they don't have as much money, let's get ice cream or a Jamba for lunch instead of a full meal. And then pent-up demand. This is one of the things the National Restaurant Association talks about, that sales are supposed to be up this year because there's so much pent-up demand. I can tell you, eating sugar-free, I've got major pent-up demand for ice cream. And then some of the trends that I think are coming up, you know, even gluten-free in ice cream, sugar-free, ice pops, smaller frozen treats so people think they're not cheating, kooky concoctions. Those again were like, you know, the bacon flavored and some really crazy ones. I noticed one was called Superman out there today. And then trucks and trailers. We're working with Rita's Ice, if you guys are familiar with them, and a lot of their franchise growth is through trucks and trailers. So you don't have to lease and don't have to have a landlord. I love that idea. And then infused ice creams, where you're seeing some other flavors, maybe a chipotle infused ice cream, organic and natural. We saw a lot of that. Tasted a homemade brand out there today. It was delicious. And then the tart frozen yogurts, like the red mangoes of the world and pink berries, they say it's reached maximum. We'll see if that happens, but they're still growing pretty rapidly, some of those tart flavors. But a lot of consumers' tastes have kind of changed and they're looking for something even more exotic. So some of the things we're gonna talk about, and yes, I talk fast. If you need notes, you can always email me afterwards and I'll send you the whole slide deck. We're also filming this on Pizza TV. Hi, Pizza TV. So we'll be up on PMQ's website, Pizza Marketplace, and Pizza Marketing Quarterly, magazine. But the success factors we're going to talk about is how to focus on your core values and unique differentiators, how to use innovative media, social media, and integrate all of the tactics that you're doing, local store marketing we're going to talk about, developing new target audiences, relationship marketing and how to make that guest connection, powerful promotions. If you have to leave early, you're going to be sorry. Maximizing sponsorship and partner opportunities. And then longevity and consistency we're going to talk about. So first of all, how many of you remember Pizza Patron when they announced they were going to take pesos for pizza? That was a big deal. It was a publicity stunt. We were working with the brand at the time, and Antonio Swad, who's pictured here, is the CEO. They had about 60 units at the time, and they're based in Dallas, and a lot of their stores were on border towns, and their brand tailors to the Latino, Latina market, and their pizza's menu boards are in Spanish, their employees speak Spanish, and they go into the Spanish neighborhoods where they build their stores. And he said, gosh, if I could just figure out a way, it was right around Christmas time, if I could figure out a way to accept pesos, because at Christmas time they come back from visiting their families in Mexico and they have pesos. If I could exchange pesos for pizza, and he said it like that. And I thought, God, what a great idea. Why don't you? A couple weeks later, he figured out how to do it. Basically, they accepted pesos, had a currency exchange laminated card for the employees, and gave change in American dollars. He was the first retail establishment in the United States next to a bank that would do currency exchange. And just think about that for a minute. In every other country, you can use US dollars. Sometimes you have to change them in, but we're like the only country that you can't use foreign currency at. So he was doing something so innovative, it pissed people off. He started to get death threats from people because they were saying that he was, motivating American people to come buy pizza with foreign currency. And a little bit about Antonio, he has a huge ego. And I said, Antonio, all you have to say is one thing. And we got worldwide press coverage about this because it was so phenomenal that somebody actually accepted a foreign currency. And he said, when was the last time you had to check somebody's ID to buy pizza? It doesn't matter what country they're from. So it was kind of a funny statement for him to say, but it was true. And the innovation of just that idea, it wasn't a discount, it was tailored to his target audience, but it drove in over 33% sales increase in less than a month. He sold probably 45 new locations, territory developments. Now he partners with a Hispanic soccer team. They sell phone cards back to Mexico. I mean, amazing way to market their brand to their target audience. So what's interesting is you gotta look at what's unique about your brand. Is it your crust? Is it your spice? Is it your serving a certain customer? So being innovative. Another success factor is integrating your marketing tools. And what I mean by that is there's so many new communication tools. You know, it used to be when you opened a restaurant, you could just flip over the now open sign and people knew you were open. Now there's so much competition, you pull up at a shopping center, do I want Mexican food? Do I want fish sticks? Do I want tacos? Do I want, what do you want? And consumers have so many choices. Well, same with the media. Not everybody has a Crackberry, not everybody's on social media, but how do you mix in that new social media with the traditional media and integrate it? I'm gonna show you. This is a brand, Firewood Cafe, that's up in Napa, California, but they also just opened a location at the airport, Oakland Airport, and they're kicking butt and taking names. And it's a wood-fired pizza. And what they had a challenge with is they opened the restaurant and they never did like a grand opening. And one of my big pet peeves is you only get a chance to open once. You might as well do it as big as you possibly can. So we said, let's just do a grand opening again. It's been about 6 months, but nobody knew. It's not like they come arrest you for throwing your grand opening 6 months later. So we invited the Chamber of Commerce. We invited all the area dignitaries. We said, let's try and get out there and take the invitations with pizzas and introduce them to the neighborhood, went to the schools, went to the TV station, went to the newspaper, went to the largest employers, took pizza and invitations and menus. And then we sent an e-blast out to all the chamber members and said, we're having a VIP tasting event. Well, they also served wine on their menu, go figure, in Napa. And they invited the wineries to come in and pour, and we set up little stations. And then instead of having customers order off the menu or whatever, we set up a buffet and we did tastes of everything on their menu. When people came to the door that night, we had them sign in. Like I just had you guys all sign in. Did everybody fill out a raffle slip? We're gonna raffle off one of my books at the end. But that's what you do. When people come in your door, you say, fill out the slip. We're having a raffle tonight. They put it in the enter to win box. And when it gets nice and quiet and you have a ribbon cutting ceremony and you say a few words, then you pull somebody's name out of the box. And you have 300 new people's email addresses to add to your list, all in one evening. So the most important thing is that you're introducing your brand by putting food in people's mouths is the best way. We didn't run any ads. We didn't do any bought media. We took time and effort to get out to the people that we needed to and then integrated what they were doing. Here's their location at the airport now. One of the things I love is that they tried to add the environment. Notice there's some umbrellas. You know, you're in an airport, but it still kind of adds to the ambiance. They still have the wood-fired stove. It's a small space, so instead of, you know, having a menu that tells you what's on the menu, they used wallpaper to wrap around some of the elements and the columns to tell people what's on the menu. And one of the really neat things they do, they're right across from a Starbucks at the airport, so they have Pete's. Everybody knows what Pete's is here? Okay. It's a little bit higher end brand than Starbucks from California too. And what they did is they set up a little kiosk. For $5, you can get a coffee and a muffin, and it's cash only. So while everybody's waiting in line at Starbucks, if you're in a hurry, you could come grab your cup of coffee and a muffin and zippity-doo-dah away. So they're really learning how to compete with the big guys, even in the airport. Another marketing success factor is local store marketing. And this is one of the things I'm known for. And I always say, you know, it's LSM or LSM, you know, is your most important tactic in your sales arsenal. We have a case study here that I want to share with you, working with this small firm locally. And all we've done for them is local store marketing, and their sales are up double digits. But it's understanding your 3 to 5 mile radius. Again, in the olden days, you used to drive around and you knew everybody in your 3 mile radius, the dry cleaner, the big box retailers, the chamber, or the city. Well, now you don't even have to leave the comfort of your own laptop. You can look up by enter your zip code of each location and it brings up your whole city data. How many people live there, what the demographics are, how much money they make per household, and it lists the top employers, the nonprofits. You can do a search for anything. So for you to put together that list, even if you've been in the business for 40 years, if you don't have that list, that's probably the most important list you can have. Because if you're slow, you pick up the phone and you call a nonprofit. How'd you like to do a fundraiser tonight? Have your GMs make calls. Have your franchisees make calls. But those are the kinds of things that local store marketing can do, and it's partnering with organizations and businesses in your own 3 to 5 mile radius. I can tell you that some of the big brands don't have to do this because they spend all their money on advertising. When McDonald's rolls out a new menu item, they run an ad, and they've got millions of dollars to do it with, right? So if you're a local guy and you have a new menu item, how do you get it out there? You've got to do probably the leanest, meanest marketing tactics you can because you don't have money for advertising. The best thing to do is invite people in to do a tasting. Have a tasting event and invite these people, the VIPs from the community. Finding your target audience. This is a new, you know, kind of an interesting way of looking at this, but a lot of brands need to reevaluate who their target audience is. You know, if you want to rejuvenate your target audience, and like I said, we've worked with a lot of brands that have been around for a long time, not the same people are going to eat at your restaurant for the rest of their lives. You have to cultivate new customers as well. And one of the ways to do that is to really look at what's in your 3 mile radius. If you're surrounded by high schools or junior highs or elementary, you know, maybe you're surrounded by a hospital, but looking at those new groups as target audiences. And then if you're not on Facebook, if you're not on Twitter, if you're not using your social media tools, how are you gonna expect to capture some of that younger market who are born with handheld devices in their hand? You know, I know that there's a lot of young kids that don't even read email anymore, so e-blasts aren't reaching them. So you really have to find a way to get on social media. And one of the best recommendations I can make is find a student. You guys have a whole convention center full of ProStart students. They're the ones that need experience in restaurants and they know how to do social media. Give them an internship. Hire them to help you do something you don't know how. And that's probably the best way is find young brand ambassadors. One brand we work with, we wrote a job description that they were looking for brand ambassadors and posted it at the campus, the university. And a bunch of students came and applied for the internship. And we gave them shirts and little coupons for free slice of pizza. And they go out on the campus, tell their friends, get more friends. You give them stickers and they put it on their bikes or their mopeds or, you know, whatever it is. But really trying to find that younger target audience and how to reach them is key. So next, relationship marketing. And what I call relationship marketing is storytelling. There's a lot of brands out there that do a great job at storytelling. And that's, you know from the get-go that you're walking into, for instance, here, White Castle. You guys probably all know the story of White Castle because they're based here. And Wendy's and Bob Evans and all those guys. But what about your brand? How do you tell a story about your brand? One of my friends is here in the audience and his brand is called Oinkadoodle Moo. If that doesn't cry out for a story, I don't know what does. But it's a smoky barbecue and they're up in Dayton. And one of the things you have to remember is that people endear themselves to stories. They want to know how you started. And everybody that has, whether you're an ice cream or you're a pizza operator, you have a story. There's a reason you got into the business. And those stories are key. People are telling those stories on Facebook now and on Twitter and in magazines. And if you're not telling your story, you're missing out on your free advertising. One of the ways that we do that for clients is you bring kids in and you do an educational class, from an Italian pizza place where we teach them about Italy to how to make pizza to why the sauce has spices in it or what garlic is. Teaching the kids endears them to your brand. I mean, I've seen my little niece go to Little Caesars and they got to eat a little pizza. They didn't learn anything, but they got free pizza. She loves Little Caesars now. So, thinking about how can you tell your stories? The VIP parties or a tasting party, use the opportunity to tell your customers what you're about. It's really important. So here's your quiz. Nobody said anything so far. Somebody has to answer. This is for an incredible prize. I brought a blanket, since we don't need them in California, to Ohio. It's a Duke marketing blanket. Who can tell me the names of the Supreme Court justices? How many can tell me the names of the Snow White Seven Dwarfs? See? Okay, the whole stunt is the dwarfs have a better story than the chief justices, don't they? He guessed it back there? Oh, okay, well, we'll hang on to this for the next quiz. You were supposed to laugh. The point is that the Seven Dwarfs have a better story than the Supreme Court justices, and it's true. They have a story, and that's the whole point, is that you want to be able to tell a story. Powerful promotions. What we want to talk about is how you started your brand or what makes you...